guy always he does it all, man. I literally sit here and do nothing. He does all the work.
Well, he did set up this table.
I set the table. I moved the table.
I mean, that is work, dude. Yeah. Yeah.
It's a little labor.
Definition of work.
That's a little labor moving there. Stuff. Awesome, man. Well, thank you. We got the great Kevin Barnett here.
Yo,
can we already say great? You got a great statue already in your career?
I mean, I don't know, man. Who knows?
I think you're getting there, man.
It's been good. It's been fun.
How's the Phoenix been treating you so far?
Phoenix, you know, it's I don't know much about it at all yet, other than just hot and desert. But I've been fine, man. I was at the pool for a little bit.
Nice.
Walked around, stared at some old ladies and shit. It's been cool.
Cougars or just gross?
Just regular old ladies. Just, yeah, I just stared at them because sometimes you got to stare.
Yeah.
You
know? Why not, man?
Yeah. I actually show went to the pool and I get sometimes I'm weird socially. Most of the times I'm not, but occasionally I am. And there's only like three people in the pool, and they're looking at me. And, you know, I guess I'm supposed to say hi, but then I didn't. And I just kind of sat near them. And then I went in the pool, and they were by me, and I didn't say a word. They just looked at me. I didn't say a word to them. I'm used to, you know, I'm from Florida where you're supposed to say hi to everybody.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I live in New York, and you don't.
No.
And then so I'm here. It's just like they were the only other people there for like an hour, and I didn't say a word.
Well, they didn't say hi to you? I mean,
they were staring at me, like, expecting me to say hi, like, you know, because it was a group of them, and I just kind of looked the other way, and, you know, but it's Hollywood, baby. It's
right, like, that's what it is. That's awesome, man. Well, thank you again for coming out, man. This is awesome. Question I wanted to start with was just the what we were talking about just a little bit ago about the being PC, man, and have you had to deal with that much recently?
I mean, it's, you know, it's everywhere right now, and it's always, like, the PC police are trying to take down everyone who says anything that could slightly be offensive at all to anyone. And it's just like, you know, it's stupid. I try not to worry about it because I feel like most of the time my intentions are like pretty clear when I'm talking about stuff. And on an off chance people do get offended, I usually like to then just fuck with them.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I don't care.
Well, I know that one bit you did. I saw one of your skits where you come out with just saying, like, hey, I want to talk about death, like, right off the bat. You know? And this is, like, that's an awesome, I mean, it's just a topic, you know, that people just don't want to hear about. But then, like, the way you were able to turn that into the fucking joke of saying, if I died, like, now, it would be awesome compared to if I died, like,
you know,
30 years or whatever. And, like, I'd be fucking lonely and at Walmart or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think that's great, though, that you're doing that. I mean, as far as being able to talk on these like issues that no one wants to fucking talk about. I mean, so what you know, are you trying to at some point, I guess, craft the joke around being, you know, so edgy or no?
I don't know if I necessarily think of it as like an edgy, like I don't go into stuff like, oh, I'm gonna be edgy or whatever, edgy, but like I feel like I've always just kind of had like a weird, like, you know, when I was a kid, I would watch, like, Disney movies and, like, relate to the villains. That's not, like, what your parents want. You see a kid relating to Scar and, you know, thinking about killing his brothers and shit. But I was just, they always thought of me as a morbid, dark kid. So that's kind of how I've been. Yeah.
Holy shit, man.
Does that tie into that social awkwardness you feel at some point?
Yeah, it's like there's part of it where it's just like I see people, I'm like, I don't need to talk to these people at all. And then there's the other part of it where it's just like sometimes I'm like, I'll see them and I'm like, well, what am I really going to – I'm going to have to struggle to think of stuff to say to these people.
Sure.
So then I just don't.
Right.
Yeah. Literally, it was like a week or two ago I was at a bar with like some people from the show we're shooting, and this girl's boyfriend, her husband, who she's always talking about, is there. She's like really excited for me to meet him, and we're sitting there at the bar, and I'm sitting next to him, and this is the coolest exchange I've ever had with a dude. Cause I'm sitting next to the dude, and he's like, we're like trying to talk to each other. I'm like, you know what, man? I don't like talking in bars, man. It's loud. I lose my voice a lot. And he's like, me too, man. We're like, all right. And then we both turned and faced the other way.
Just that was
stood next to each other in silence.
That's
was
awesome.
Great.
Oh, that is like the perfect situation. Because I feel that too a lot. Like I'm an introvert that you have to be an extrovert when you go out and do things.
Yeah.
And you would rarely find that connection with someone like, how about we just don't talk?
Yeah, no, exactly.
Well, silence is an important thing. And people don't, they don't like take that, you know, everybody's just got to come up with some shit just to fill the air sometimes. Yeah,
exactly. And it's weird, though, because sometimes I will be an extrovert, like a lot of the times, but I just got to be in the mood for it.
Sure.
And so half the time I'm not in the mood for it, and just like,
has that ever affected your career as far as like trying to go out and like mingle or network and all that bullshit, or has it just always been, you just do, or you know the right
people?
Yeah,
like, I just kind of did what I did, and I never thought of it as like networking or whatever. I was like, oh, I'll hang out, talk
with
to these people,
guys.
And they're cool.
Yeah.
And then just, you know, but I never like sought to, like, oh, I'm going to talk to, so, or I got to talk to these people.
Sure.
And I think that might have probably helped me, too, because I come off, like, sort of half the time disinterested in people. But, like, I don't know.
It's just you.
Yeah.
Do you find a lot of comics are like that? Like, other guys you interact with?
Decent, you know, like, here and there. Like, it depends on a dude. There's a lot of dudes who are, like, constantly on, and they're constantly trying to be funny and make jokes, and I hate that, and I've never been that type of dude. Like, I'll be funny if I happen to be, but, like, it's not, like, my thing or whatever, you know?
Right.
It's weird to see a guy do that, like, or I guess a girl. I was reminds me of a time I was in L.A. We're at this hotel party, the Standard, in, I don't know if you guys know
what it is. Yeah.
And they had a party there, and I was there, and there was this guy that was, he told me he's a lawyer, but he was trying to be an actor, and he was on. I mean, he was trying 110% at this party with us. We're like, fucking nobodies. Why are you trying with us? What's going on here? But it was the weirdest thing to watch. Like, he was really trying to act for the whole, like, 2 or 3 hours we were there.
And that's L.A., man. Like, I don't live there, but I've, you know, spent, like, you know, a month or two here and there, and then go back and forth. But I've heard of stories, like, literally people are getting their car towed by, like, a, you know, and a tow truck driver sees, like, their headshot in the windshield, is like, oh, shit, and then they bring out their stuff, like, try to just be on as they're towing them, and they'll still tow them after that. But it's crazy.
We talked with Jesse Joyce about that, you know, that just the difference between New York and L.A., and it does. It's just, like, it's such, you have to be constantly pitching stuff to everybody because you don't know. Jesse brought up that story, or just that bit about, like, you know, if you see some guy jerking off on a train, like, you can't tell him to stop in L.A. because he could be some eccentric, like, fucking, like, producer, and you don't want to piss him off because you won't be on his show. Whereas, you know, a place like New York or L.A., you'd be like, fuck you, man, stop, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you got to police those scumbags, you know?
And I feel like in New York, there's so many, there's tons of artists, too, man. Not as many as L.A., but they're everywhere. But I think in L.A., like, the difference is hope. Everybody in L.A. is just an full abundance of hope. Yeah. It's all beautiful out there, man. You have the pool and stuff. You're like, just
sunny,
right.
That's why.
Yeah. You're right next to it. So it's just like,
you get, you get treated too well out there. You get delusional.
Yeah, exactly.
So how much time have you spent in L.A.?
I go out there a decent amount. Like, I'd go out there and, like, you know, I'd consult or write on things here and there, and that'd just be, like, a month or two here and there, and then I'll go out for, like, a week. And I'm probably going to go out, like, twice this summer.
Nice.
Go out a decent amount.
Yeah. Is that the MTV2 thing? Is that out there?
No, all the MTV stuff I did was in New York.
New York.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know. Like, everything's in L.A. That's on TV.
Everything's on point. Yeah, exactly.
I'm an idiot.
Now, there's a ton of stuff, like, lately in New York, there's been a ton of stuff, like, production-wise, which is cool and funny, though, because I remember there's always, like, an exodus of comedians to New York, and whenever it was, like, 3 years ago or so, like, that it happened where just a ton of the New York guys everybody liked that hadn't quite, like, broke yet all moved to L.A. and got nothing, and all the dudes that stayed in New York just started getting all this TV stuff because it just started happening. Yeah. And then a bunch of them ended up moving back to New York.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you feel that pressure? Have you felt it at all? Like, fuck, I got to move somewhere. I got to, like...
Nah, like, I mean, they, you know, my manager and agent are like, oh, you should move to L.A. They're always, like, trying to get me to go, but I don't necessarily feel a need to right now. I mean, I'm sure there would be more opportunities and stuff, but there's a lot in New York, and I go to L.A. enough, I can go more. I just don't want to live there yet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it just a personal reason, or is it just...
I don't know.
The culture?
Honestly, I don't even understand why. Because the first couple of years I was in New York, I hated it. So at a base level, New York as a place, I hate. I don't like it. It's way too hot in the summer, and then half the buildings don't have AC. So you're hot outside, and you go inside, and you're hot still. You're just sweating all the time. People smell bad. Wintertime, it's cold as shit. Yeah. And it's miserable, and somehow I'm still like, ah, no, this is where I want to be.
Well, you know, some of the other guys that we were mentioning, you know, Sean and Dan and all those guys, you know, the common theme is just that's the place to go to be a stand-up comic. And is that kind of still where you're at? Are you still just really wanting to hone in on the craft of stand-up, or are you wanting to do other, like, show production things?
I kind of want to try and just... be equal parts of as much of it as I can.
Sure.
like it's a weird thing where I came into stand up originally because like I wanted to do sketch and all that stuff. And I thought, you know, because Chappelle and all them dudes, they did it, yeah. like, and I was like, oh, that's the way that you do it. But right. that's not really the way that you do it. But then now that I've been doing a lot of the sketch and all that in the past, like, couple of years, it's like stand-up is just, like, the most fun part of it.
Right.
But I haven't been able to do as much lately. So I want to be able to do the stand-up. But it's, like, a weird balance because
sure.
you make a lot of money doing the TV stuff, and that also will help, you know, if stuff pops, get people to come to the shows and... you get better money or whatever, but you can't just, you have to take away time from stand-up to do that, so your stand-up will suffer. But then it's like, it's a weird, like, equation of just, I feel like I just do it in waves. Like, this right. period is more sketch or acting or writing, and this period is more stand-up or whatever.
Yeah, and obviously, I mean, I'm assuming that most of the stand-up influences the sketch writing.
Yeah, right? Yeah, a lot. Yeah. Like, I feel like there's so many of the sketches that I would write would just come off of just like either a premise that I was like, oh, this not necessarily work as a stand-up bit, but right. like I can get it, or this shit that worked as stand-up, and right. I was like, I can see this as a sketch.
You know? How do you know the difference though when it is and isn't?
I feel like sometimes with some of the stand-up that might work better as a sketch, it's just like it requires a lot of explaining and just like imagery,
mm-hmm.
and you can get it to work, but it might just work better as a bit.
Yeah, it seems like a thing you would have to, like a skill you'd have to develop when you write something, how then to navigate it. Do you push it down a certain path or another one, down into sketch or TV or something visual or something just like stand-up? How do you develop, or have you found that you do both? You'll take it on the stage to kind of figure it out and then also maybe try to figure it out as far as pushing it down into like a sketch.
Yeah, like, some of them are literally, like, I've done them as a stand-up thing, and it might not even work at all, but, like, it's, like, it might just be, like, I feel like with our show, we do a bunch of, like, wordplay stuff, so we had this sketch they just put online that was, it was a Batman thing, so Batman dies, and the only one that can replace him is R&B sensation Brian McKnight, and it's called The Dark McKnight. And it's just like, you can't do a stand-up thing about that, but it's like The Dark McKnight. It was just mm-hmm. a funny word, and then we got Brian McKnight to come do it, and he's in the sketch singing it. Yeah. So it's just like...
Oh, that like works? That. Then.
Yeah.
That's great.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah. And then there's still like sketches, like sometimes, you know, like we will... There's sometimes where you have to like, there'll be a great idea, but somehow it just doesn't, we don't end up using it just because... we have too many of a similar idea, or like it just like time wise, whatever doesn't work out. But
wow, well, how did you get involved in that, in the writing? You said that you thought that was a natural path, so you got involved in that first, or
well, I did stand up first, and I guess like people always said that like, oh, the way your stand up is like it would work well as like writing, so people would like try to push me to write.
Well, you're a story developer, right?
Yeah. I do like mostly stories and stuff, so people would push me to write, and the first thing I did that was like, that went really well was this web series I did with my friend Jermaine, who's also on the Truth TV show. I'm on the Friends of the People sketch show. And we did a thing called Homo Thugs. It was about two homophobic gangsters that were clearly in the closet and that just lived in Brooklyn. And they were like very just aggressively homophobic, but clearly very obviously gay.
Yeah.
But neither of them would admit it to each other or knew. And so it was like, that went like sort of viral and led to like a bunch of stuff, and like I ended up getting a bunch of writing work off of that, and then it ended up coming, helped me get into the show or whatever.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah. Do you like that? I always feel like I should ask it, because with Jesse Joyce, I felt like I should ask too, because he was a prolific writer as well.
Mm.
Do you prefer one over the other? If you had, in a perfect situation, if you could plan out the rest of the like your next 30, 40 years, would you do both?
Oh, yeah, I definitely do both. Because I think that what it is, too, is that doing both makes me not get tired of one.
Right.
You know? Like, whenever, like...
Variety.
Like, in the past, like, a little less than a year since we've been, like, we just finished shooting, like, 3 weeks ago, I wasn't able to do as much stand-up. But whenever I go do stand-up, it's just, like, I enjoy it way more than when I'm doing, like, 3-4 sets a night every night, and I'm, like, you know... You can't go to dinner. You can't see movies with people who see movies, like happy hours, none of that stuff. And so it's just like when I break away from the shoot and I go back, I'm like, oh, this is why. This is dope. Yeah.
Yeah, man. That's awesome.
But you also, I wonder if part of you thinks, because if I'm not a comic, but if I was, I think I would think this way. Because I'm neurotic like that. I would think, okay, yeah, I enjoy doing both, but if I really want to perfect one, I have to just do one. Like, dedicate all my time and energy to doing that one thing and doing it perfectly. And that's not really realistic, but do you think about that at times?
Here and there, I will. But there's also the side of it, too, where I think doing this, doing the other stuff helps my stand-up. Like, I feel like I'm a better, like, I've always been, like, sort of, like, laid back, whatever, and I'll have, like, little things where I'm, like, doing act-outs and whatever, but I just feel like I've gotten better as a performer and as a writer just from, like, because, you know, writing for a show is, like, tons of hours of writing. Like, it's crazy hours of writing. Mm-hmm. And it just makes it easier, I guess, when I do focus on the stand-up. But then that's, like, it makes me feel like I get a little, like, I slack a little bit on stand-up because it's, like, oh, I can just kind of haphazardly do this and I already know, like, how it's going to, you know?
Absolutely. How much of, like, the stand-up is influenced by just improvising?
A decent amount, actually. Like, I feel like it's hard to describe, like, saying that, like, I have a process so much as, like, I know, like, I'll have, like, an idea, and a lot of times I'll just have an idea and I'll go up and I'm, like, I know points in the idea and I'll just kind of talk around the idea until it becomes something. And so it's sort of like with a lot of my stuff lately, I haven't like written it out so much as like I have, like if I was to look at my notebook, it's just the idea and then like a sentence here and there. Mm-hmm. And I'll just kind of talk around that.
Yeah, I know talking to even Rick, he says he, you know, writes on stage. You know, he just has to just throw out some premise and see how the crowd reacts to it. Yeah. And then from there, you just kind of, you go back and you start, you know, fine-tuning it, you know, and cutting down the fat or whatever. What are your thoughts about that, about trimming, you know, the fat on a joke? Like, you're taking out words. Do you go that extent with your stuff?
Yeah, here, like, that's, and people to a fault sometimes. Like, I like exposition. Mm-hmm. And back in the day in high school and college, people used to always call me Backstory Barnett because I'd always give people the backstory they didn't necessarily need. I still like it. And I like people.
Set them up.
Yeah. I like people, like, waiting for a laugh. But a lot of times I will be like, all right, I got to sit down and just cut a lot of this stuff and just get it to where it should be. But I do like, because I guess it's just part of me being, like, into, like, stories and stuff. And that's how I've always been. And so I've never... Growing up, I wasn't into stand-up. I was never even starting it. I was never into the process of stand-up. I don't have, like, the religious, like, people get, like, crazy about, like, the process and this is art and this is blah, blah. Right. I'm not very much like that. I'm kind of just like, I just kind of do what I want. I'm like, I like doing it this way, so this is how I'm going to do it.
Yeah, that's awesome, though. I mean, because I think have you ever, like, forced yourself to try to write just one-liners, just try to come up with just throwing those out there and being as sharp as possible?
Because that was the thing. Like, it used to be just 100% long stories.
Storytelling, yeah.
And here and there, like, I'd have, like, shorter stuff sprinkled in. And it was kind of a thing where, you know, 3-4 years ago, whatever it was, and I was in New York, and I'd see guys like Jezelnik and whoever else that, like, had, like, nothing but, like, these great one-liners. And it was such a different way of writing and doing stand-up that I ever did, that for a while I was like, I should just try to make a bunch of these, because it'll just challenge my brain in a different way to write these short ones. And so, you know, in New York, a lot of times you're doing these open mics and it's like 2 minutes, 3 minutes, sometimes even one. Yeah. So then I had, at that point, I used to do like a bunch of like really short ones, and I liked them a lot, but
one minute?
Yeah, there's mics where it's like 1 or 2 minutes, yeah.
Holy shit.
Multiples in a night, or you just go in, you got a minute?
One at that spot. Right, like, and then you move to
the next spot and try another joke. Jeez,
that sounds so. It sounds like, okay, you get a minute, maybe in another 20 minutes you'll get another minute. Yeah. But no, it's like you get a bunch of guys get a minute, and how does that work? And then there's like a main act or something?
That's just like the, because, you know, like I said before, the whole thing about hope, New York is a very, very sad place. And the open mics in New York, 95% of them, there's nobody there but the comedians that are there.
Right.
So you'll be at an open mic, and if it's a popular one, there's like 30, 40, sometimes 60 comedians in the room. And so, like, everybody just goes and does their thing. Half the time, no one's even listening to you while you're doing it. And the people that are listening are just comedians, and they don't appreciate shit.
Yeah,
and
I don't give a shit about you.
You gotta, so they do these, like, really short ones, and you get out whatever your jokes were, and then you go to the next open mic. And one of my favorite ones back in the day used to be this mic at the Pit on Tuesdays at 11 o'clock. They still do it, but it's like the format's different. And that was like a 2-minute mic, And I think when it was, like, the most popular, it would be, like, 60, 70 comics there. And a bunch of people would go and, like, not get on. Like, you'd go there and just you wouldn't even get to. You'd wait and you wouldn't even get on at the open mic. And everybody would go up and they'd choose, like, five people to nominate for a joke of the night. And a lot of the people go to the same open mics. And the caveat was that you had to have done a joke that no one had heard, or at least if they'd heard it, it had to be that they definitely only heard it that week. And you get nominated for joke of the night. And then, yeah, whoever wins, they would give you, like, a free beer or something like that.
That seemed like a great way to develop.
It was a great way to develop,
comics. Like,
well, yeah.
That's why New York seems to be, like, the place for that, just for that type of reason.
But I think
that
stuff like that's going on in L.A. Like, I heard, have you heard of Tony Hinchcliffe?
Mm-hmm. Tony Hinchcliffe.
No.
I think he's hooked up with, like, Tom Segura. You mentioned those guys earlier. And Ryan Redband and that whole group of comics. But they do a thing where it's 1 minute, and they record you, and then there's Hinchcliffe and a few other comics that are more well-established in the area. And it has to be exactly a minute, and then they judge you. Like, so they have a number of comics go up, and it has to be new material. It has to fit within certain parameters. But it's a great way to develop, I think, new material and artists and everything. It's like, so I think there's these things going on at both ends of the spectrum here in New York and L.A., and people are trying to. Maybe it is because there's a comedy boom or something that people keep talking about.
We're definitely in a boom. We keep talking, me and my friends back in New York keep talking about, like, oh, it's definitely a boom right now, which means we got about, like, 5-6 years to get this money before it all falls through,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, because you can go back and hear the stories of guys in the 80s that hit that boom and, like, they just kind of, like, DePaulo talked about it. He's like, it's just how it was then. You just started to make money.
Everyone
assumed that's how it was.
And it's funny, too, there's another side of it where it's, like, now, like, a lot of networks are doing, like, they're trying to get more diversity in their programming, which is really great. They got, like, you know, they're putting Asians on TV. It's crazy. They got Asian shows. They got, like, there's a bunch of, like, new black shows coming out, and we've been saying the same shit. Just, like, oh, pretty soon they're going to, like, realize, like, wait a minute. White people are going to be like, wait a minute, prime time? That used to be our time. We got to get this back, and it's going to be right back to the old guard, you know,
old classics. But That so-called prime time is gonna fizzle out. It's last death cry.
Oh yeah, TV
is
like
now.
Yeah, it's going it's, out it's in general. Out.
So we can use that old, like, the template from 80s and 90s where there were booms and stuff, but things are changing so much that this boom is way different than any other boom.
Yeah,
and there's no telling what the hell's gonna happen. What's gonna become of it? Because it will. The bubble will pop at some point.
Yeah.
What do you think about that as far as about you catching the right end of the bubble and being able to ride it out?
I mean, it's lucky. It's a good time. And I think, but right now, the main difference between, like, this boom and, like, previous ones is just that there's the internet. So it's kind of hard to, you know, like, people will get popular on the internet, and, like, it's kind of hard to hide guys that are, like, legitimately very, very talented if they're putting stuff out in the right way, because people will see it. And back in the old days, it was like stuff got, like, way too, comedy was just everywhere, and they were just putting up people who were terrible just to fill rooms. But now it's like, I feel like, just in general, you know, every art kind of evolves. Like, it was the same thing with there was only a booming breakdancing or whatever, and it was everywhere, and then it died. And it's just like, but now if you look at breakdancers now, it's sort of in another boom, but it's a smaller, more controlled boom, and the guys are, like, crazy just because everyone has the internet to study and learn and all that. And I feel like there's a ton of comedians now where it's a weird thing where it's like people try to shut people down for talking about stuff, so it's almost harder to talk about shit. But at the same time, people just, like, if you think about, like, jokes wise, a lot of these girls and dudes just have, like, incredible jokes, and there's just so many of them with, like, legitimately really good jokes.
Right.
And just because everybody has so much, they can, like, study and learn and be like, well, I'm going to be different in this way. And everyone knows, like, their process a little bit better, I think.
You're right, man. That's the weird thing about now. Things that, like, you would say, oh, this is on the internet. No one could do that. There's no way a guy could do that. It's just no way. And there's, and you done. Look at the video, you're like, what the fuck?
Right. Yeah.
There's no way a guy's doing a backflip on a dirt bike. I swear to you. And then now they're doing double backflip. Like, So
everything just escalates, you know?
With you guys, too, right?
Yeah.
But then do you feel the pressure from having your stuff out there and then having to constantly develop new stuff?
I think it just helps. Like, that's the thing. It's like there's always this thing of this fear of like, oh man, I'm gonna burn out, or I just wrote this joke, I'm never gonna be able to write a better joke than that. And like 2 months later, you're like, oh well, that joke kind of sucks. It just kind of moves like that all the time. So, and I think it's just because there's also the side where, like, you know, you'll think of something and you'll be like, I wonder if anyone's thought of this. And sometimes you go and look on the internet, see if somebody did, and they might have. And so it makes it harder nowadays to just straight up steal people's shit. Like, back in the day, people would be like, oh, you see a joke. I'm like, I'm going to do that. You can make a whole career off of just watching other people's jokes.
Sure.
And now it's like, it's much harder to do that, which is cool.
Right. What are your thoughts about the quality over quantity then? I mean, do you think it's more important to just be relevant and just be producing amount? Or do you think, and is that going to destroy comedy just because of the fact that people are coming up with such ridiculous stuff for the sake of being relevant compared to actually developing some bit or, you know?
I do think, for example, the whole idea of putting out an hour every year, I don't like that. Like, really? I think, like, yeah, I know, like, it's cool that people do it.
Right.
But to me, the problem I see is it's like the guys that have been doing it, their specials every year have been still great, but not as good as when it was like they would take 3 years in between each one. Mm. So it's like, for example, like, CK is like, he's like the guy who's like leading that whole path.
And right.
All of his last specials have been really good. They've been great. But if you look at back when he was making them every couple of years, it's like those were like incredible. And if you were to take his last three specials and distill that into one, it'd have been fucking groundbreaking. Right, it'd have been insane. But everyone has this push now to put it out every year, which is like, what does that really mean, you know?
Right.
That's, and like, they're going to be great jokes, and they're going to be, but it's like, how many incredible ideas can you really have within a year and trying to refine while you're also doing all of that other stuff?
Sure.
You know?
Well, I know, like, you know, his idea from that, speech he did for Carlin's memorial was just that, you know, to him, it's like an onion, you know, you're just pulling back more and more layers of yourself, and you can only go deeper and deeper into yourself. You know, you could, you know, start with something like family, you know, those topics, you break that down, then you go into yourself, and then what about feelings and those topics, and then so on and so forth. I mean, there's got to be a point where it's like, what's left, you know?
Yeah,
I don't
know.
That's fucking crazy to think.
And it's just like, to me, and I don't know if this is like a controversial opinion, it's like, if I was to look at the specials, like, they're really funny, they're great, and they make you laugh, make you think or whatever.
Yeah.
But there's only so many things that are truly going to make you be like, holy shit, like, I have never thought of that within, like, you can come up with within an amount of time, you know?
Yeah.
He does it, but it's just like, if he were to take those last three and just make that one thing, it's just like, that would have been.
Why do you think we've had that push lately? Because that's a really new thing to do.
Well, I think it is because of technology, isn't it? I mean, it's forcing people to be relevant.
I feel like he's the one who's definitely leading the charge. I know he just kind of had this whole idea of, if I'm not able to put out one a year and this is my whole life and my job and career, then I'm terrible. And I don't know, like, I feel like I kind of disagree. You know, it's just like, and there's dudes that don't do it, like Chris Rock doesn't do that, and Seinfeld doesn't do that, all these other guys. It's just a different way of doing it.
Right.
And to me, CK can do it, and he does it great, and I'm saying those specials are all still great, but I'm just saying, if it was one instead of like three within 3 years, it would have been incredible.
Right. Has he talked about why exactly he chose to do that?
I think it was just that thing of like, if I can't do this, then what am I doing, you know? And so then it's making a bunch of other comedians do it, and I don't think everybody can do it, you know? So it's it might drive down a lot of people.
Have a backlash
quality,
to it.
You know?
It's going to be interesting, I think, to see it play out in a 5 to 10 year span, like, because it can't last. I don't think something, that guy is at the top of his game. He's running at a really fast pace. I think it might die out with him, or it might not, but I think it'll be interesting to look back after like a 10-year span and think what's become, how has that influenced the present? In the same way the 90s did, or like a Carlin or a
Pryor,
Bill Hicks, the way those guys came about and made their own brand of comedy, and then how that influenced. So I'm interested to see that. Since I don't know exactly what his reasons are for that, how do you think that's going to affect the future?
I don't know. I mean, hopefully it doesn't drive stuff down in a bad way. But if you think about it, it's kind of almost cave into that whole consumerism that is nowadays. Everybody's like, I need it now. I need more shit. You know, you were saying, like, you do comedy. It's like, oh, you got to be on Twitter. You got to be on YouTube. Right. You got to be on Vine. You got to be making Instagram videos. You got to do all those things. So it's just like, it's just one of those things where it's like, oh, yeah, we're giving them all this stuff. But does it ultimately make stuff weaker?
Yeah.
And I think it kind of does. Even though it's still really good, I do think it kind of does.
Sure. We talk about it. Have you ever seen that movie, The Truman Show?
Fucking forever. Yeah, I don't remember exactly how it all went. But
the very end where he, like, you know, the boat hits the fucking screen and he realizes it's all bullshit and he gets up and goes into the dark room and he talks about that, like, how, you know, we need to have that dark room as artists. We need to just kind of saturate and be kind of in our own little place for a while and just kind of build, you know, content based off of that and then release it, you know? I don't know. I know, like, even that new thing that's happening right now, like Periscope, the app. People are, I mean, that's like instant feeds now. It's like, how fucking much can you be entertaining people before you burn out, you know? Like, I don't know. That's such a crazy...
Yeah.
But there is something really cool to it. Like,
sure.
The objective person would see,
like... It
brings
a different thing out, for sure.
This is cool. Like, you get to see a side of someone's life that you never... Like, you would always want to see that, and now technology has advanced to such a point where you can. Like, we could be doing it right now, and then it's gone. Or, no, it stays in a file, right, with Periscope?
I think it stays in a file, and you can upload it later. I think it's on a backlog or something. But
Which is weird.
I think
totally
the big
weird.
Thing, you know, as any artist and trying to be a master of a craft is that you have to put the 10,000 hours practice in, right?
You
have to develop that time and skill to really be sharp at it, right? And there's, you know, it's that thing of, like, people are being seen too soon, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, it's a lot of, like, and I wonder about that, too, because that was, like, you know, we were talking about the old boom and how it was, like, they were just comedians were just getting up and they were terrible. I feel like, you know, there's, right now, it's like everything is like a cycle. You know, everybody, every year, there's the Montreal Fest. Every year, there's people doing concerts for half hour. Every year, there's people doing their Adam Devine house party or whatever else other little stand-up thing there is. There's so many different things where it's like every year there's a number of people that have to get this thing, but then it's like, well, how many people, like, should have actually been doing it when it comes around? It's like, how many people are left? Like, every time it comes around, it's like, well, who's left? And it's like, all right, it's kind of like, all right, well, I guess, yeah, you can go do it. And it's just like...
You're the next guy, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
You're here, so...
Yeah, you're just kind of waiting around for the wheel to come back. And it's interesting. I mean, and it's not that, like, any of these people who are... I still think most of the people doing all this stuff are great.
Great,
but it's just
kind
of a
thing
where it's like, there's a wheel spinning, and there's not always people that can be on the wheel, but it's just like, it kind of has to come around every time.
Absolutely. Well, this is a question that I think we asked Seton, and I just kind of want to get your opinion on it. What do you think the next evolutionary, like, standpoint is in, like, stand-up itself? Do you think it's going to reach a different thing, such as, you know, even a visual aspect to it, you know? Do you think that needs to be incorporated into stand-up now?
Well, I feel like, and you kind of see it in a lot of the shows that come out and, like, people's specials, where it's just like, it's not, a lot of things aren't just straight up stand up.
Right.
Because people get bored easily nowadays.
Right.
So it's like the Adam Devine house party thing was like, they all, like, it wasn't really sketches in between, but it's kind of like there's a house party going on during the stand up set. So, like, there's a whole story kind of to get people engaged. A lot of people are doing their hour specials, and, like, you know, like, Chelsea Peretti's did a bunch of, like, weird, crazy stuff, and it was great.
Right.
And there's a bunch of, like, weird, crazy stuff just to kind of, like, keep you
engaged,
in tune with it. So it's kind of, like, happening. I feel like a lot of people who are doing specials, there's always, like, there's a biography element to it. They'll cut away here and there. There's,
some,
like,
theatrics,
some weird sketches.
A lot of experimentation.
Yeah.
That's kind of cool to see, though. I mean, I think it would be really interesting. I mean, people have been doing it with music, you know, for a while now, too.
It's cool to kind of, like, see what shapes the people and, like, what shapes the bits and stuff like that. So,
I guess in a weird way, that's kind of, at that point, you just start to become just an artist at that point, right? And you kind of have to, you know, be somewhat relevant in music and visual arts and then comedy, and then you're starting to kind of glue all these different medias together to create this live production, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe that's what it's going to be. I don't know. Like, fuck, I don't know. It's
crazy. As someone that enjoys the visual aspect of it, I think a lot of it is really coming, it's come a long way in that sense. Like,
Well, the house party, even the lights and shit that happened before the show, spinning around, getting people on gigs crap. I mean,
that's... But even the recorded specials, like, everything looks better. Everything is the quality. More visually interesting. You've got more talented people because everyone has more capability. Like, we've got cameras here. We've got lights here. It's not that hard. So if you have even a little bit of money and talent, you can make a thing look really good. Yeah. And that does, I think, make it appeal to a broader audience. If you can, it's not so niche now. Because to me, comedy was always kind of niche. Like,
sure,
you get on the comedy train because you enjoy that. Maybe you're kind of a nerdy dude, or you're a little more intellectual or something if you like that kind of comedy. But now it seems a lot more broad.
Like, well, that's kind of what I was saying before. What was like every aspect of it kind of makes you better at stand-up if that's what you want to do, or whatever it is your main thing is. So it's kind of like, there is a certain thing where it could be like sort of overexposure, but it's like, you know, like if you're writing scripts, it makes you better writing stand-up. If you do a podcast every week, it kind of makes you better at just like talking, like if you're just gonna be on stage talking with people. Like, I feel like every bit of it helps. And to me also, it's almost like a fail-safe, you know, if it's like, if I'm like not doing well in stand-up and I'm not getting booked places, I still have scripts I can be sending out and writing and getting hired to write for scripts. If I'm not getting hired to write scripts, trying to act a little bit, you know, trying to produce a little bit. I think it's just like, it's kind of like backup plans within what is the supposed to not have a backup plan.
Sure, you know? Absolutely. Do you use different medias to inspire you? I mean, are you reading a lot? Are you listening to a lot of music?
I used to read a ton, but it's been tough to read in the past.
What were you reading?
I would just read like whatever. I don't even, like, literally since like college, I haven't really read. I've read like three books in college. I just get busy, and then like I want to read, and I'm like, I should be writing and stuff. But like literally, I've had a book in my book bag for the past like 6 months that I've been like, I'm probably like 70 pages in. But it's just like I'll sit down and I'll read it for like half an hour, and then I'll put it away and I get busy and forget it even exists.
Right.
And it's just kind of been the content this cycle.
That's kind of my process of reading too. Like, I've got too many things I'm doing in a day, and I'm like, fuck, if I spend an hour reading, that's an hour I can't like work on this thing.
Yeah, no, exactly. So it's tough, but I think in general, and I've always kind of had this idea that most of art, if you boil it down, kind of comes to the same. You're trying to achieve the same things.
Sure.
Like, if you're talking about like anything, like jazz, rap, comedy, it's all like you're basically trying to, you figure out who you are, exactly who you are, and what that means to you, and then basically it's just trying to make the world understand what you're talking about and your opinions and agree with it. And so you see a lot of that in just across the board. And it's interesting because I listen to like a lot of hip hop, and a lot of the rappers, they're funny, and I feel like they could be great comedians if they wanted to.
Sure.
And then you see, like, you know, with Donald Glover, it's like the dude is like now like Grammy nominated rapper. And I remember when he first, it was like coming out, like telling people, he'd been rapping for a while, but when people first started, knew he was rapping, people were kind of laughing about it, like, oh, you know, whatever. And like the dude
not
is just like,
serious.
He's a beast at all of it, you know? And I used to be a jazz major in college.
No shit.
And half those dudes that I played jazz with are some of the funniest people I've ever met. And it's like, if they sat, and you know, people say, oh, so-and-so is funny, but like they wouldn't be funny in a stand-up way. But like these guys, I'm like, if they sat down, I'm like, oh, I'm going to do stand-up. I feel like we'll all be great at it, you know?
That's awesome. What'd you play?
I played tenor and barry sax.
Nice, man.
Yeah.
So has that really influenced you, like the jazz aspect into your comedy?
I feel like it was like, it kind of just influenced like my approach to it.
Sure.
I guess, you know, and just like how my whole, like that whole, just what I was saying, like figuring out, like I kind of knew that early on, like figure out what I am, like learn, like you learn all the like basics and stuff and like
the
how
vocabulary.
Like, and then it's just like you, once you know that stuff, you figure out who you are and what separates you from what other people are doing.
That's cool.
And you just pretty much just exploit your differences to you. And it just becomes, you know, you basically find yourself even just as a person, not even on stage.
Man, that's cool. Like. Yeah, I play drums, so that's why I was just like...
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah, Max Roach and all those guys. Those were my dudes, and like, I mean, it's just, I'm starting to get into comedy now myself, and you know, it really has, the parallels of the two are very tight.
It's the exact same.
It's crazy.
And it was funny, like, I remember, it was sort of like a sage thing to say, and you know, you wouldn't think of this dude as like a sage type dude, but I remember like in college, like probably like my first or second year doing comedy, this dude, Keith Tatara, was in town. And I was a jazz major in college at that time, and he was a jazz major in college. And I barely spoke to him, but I was talking to him, and he said he was a jazz major. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's what I do, man. And he was like, oh, really? I was like, yeah. Mm-hmm. He's like, he was about to leave. He's just like, take everything you learned from jazz and apply it to comedy. And then he just left. And I was
that's
like,
brilliant.
It took me a while to figure out what that meant, but it's mm-hmm. basically, it's like that. Same, yeah. Yeah, it's the same. It's all the same.
Man, that's really cool to see that, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, like. Like I asked earlier about the improvising on stage with people. I mean, it's the same thing. It's the same thing of throwing out, an idea, whether it's musical or just, you know, a word or a concept, and people, how they respond to that, you know? And, the old saying, you know, you make a mistake in jazz, make it twice, and then it's called jazz, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't know if that would work with comedy, but sure. I mean, why the hell not, you know?
Yeah.
Why not put people in that uncomfortable zone just to see how they react?
Just it's building that tension until you get to the release. Just like, yeah,
that's what it is, man. That's cool.
And it's kind of like, I think on it might have been even just on Block Party, like Chappelle said a very similar thing. He was like playing at Round Midnight, Thelonious Monk thing, mm-hmm. and he was just like, he's, and that's like the only song he knows how to play, but he just kept saying like all you young comedians out there, study Monk, trust me. And it's just like, Monk was just a master, just building that tension, do some really out there weird shit, but he would always resolve, always come back to it, and it was.
So is the whole concept of jazz? Is that what I'm hearing? Like this thing about building tension.
Sure. Well, that's music just in general. Yeah, yeah. I mean that's really? What it is. It really is taking these sounds and creating tension. Bach did that. You know, Mozart, all those guys did that. Creating this thing, and just letting it resolve itself. I mean, it's the yin and yang of life, really.
Yeah,
I mean,
basically.
That's what we're doing, you know?
Essentially.
That's great.
But to the non-musically trained, what does that mean? Like, to someone listening or even to me, that I haven't been trained the same way you guys have been trained. So what is that?
One of the biggest things, too, like, about jazz in particular is so much of jazz, as much as, like, you're within a group while you're playing, depending on if it's a small group or big group, but so much of jazz is also about the individual. And so it's just like you're figuring out what your sound is and how you have to know, like, the basics. You have to learn all the, you know, all the OG stuff, but you figure out what your sound is and you figure out how to translate that into a way that everyone can understand what you're expressing. But at the same time, like, you got to listen. Like, you have to listen to, like, the vibe of the room. You gotta listen to what the drummer's playing, you gotta listen to what the piano's playing, and you go back and forth listening to each other, so you're communicating with jazz. Mm-hmm. So it's about you, the individual, but at the same time, you have to be very aware of everything that's happening around you. And I feel like it all kind of becomes the same thing.
So that translation is then you interacting with the audience.
You interacting with the audience, and you, just like the world, man. And the main thing is just like that whole boiling down what you are. And jazz is very much about being like, what sets you apart? What's your sound? What's your whole thing? And you figure that out, and then you put it out. But you have to have the vocabulary there in the first place.
That's, yeah.
Because you know what? I always thought of jazz as just, when you guys were talking about it initially, what I thought was about what I know of jazz. And that's like you learn the rules, and then you
break
them.
Yeah, right? And that's also pretty much... That's the most simplest way to say it. It's like you learning the rules, which is like you figuring out, like, you know, learning all the basics. You figure out what you can do that separates you from that, and you never want to do stuff that people are already doing. Mm-hmm. And you just figure out how to put that out in a way that is true to what you are, but people can also still understand and vibe with.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
One of my favorite drummers, Bernard Purdy, he talked about that, about basically, as a musician, and I guess it's the same thing with comedy. I mean, you basically are learning to define your voice and on your instrument or whatever your craft is. You're defining your voice, and you are building your own character, right? You're defining who you are through this thing, this media. And then, but it's your job ultimately to stay as humble as possible in that process, because that's ultimately what, I guess, creates your human aspect. You're just being a fucking just nice person, or just being a person, right?
Yeah.
And you're just trying to do that. And I think with jazz, you know, there's so many guys that talk about that, about how you are just defining your sound by breaking all these rules, you know, and you're combining these different elements. There's a great group by the name Bad Plus. Did you ever listen to that?
Yeah.
David King and all those guys. Like, he taught, I mean, they almost put like a punk rock aspect into jazz. Like, and that was more of his background too, was he grew up playing, you know, punk drums and all this stuff. And then, you know, now he's applied that to his jazz. So it takes on this just different feeling. And is it considered jazz, yes or no? And like, people debate that shit all the time. And whatever. It's the same thing with comedy, though. It really is. It's crazy how, they're, like I said, the parallels are there.
Yeah.
It's fun. I don't know. I have fun with it. So.
Yeah.
It's
cool, man.
Well, what I think, like, when I see people in the audience and even myself really connect, and then when I think of how that ties into what you guys are talking about, it's the fact that it feels like it's being said for the first time on stage.
Yeah, yeah.
So much so that some people are like, can I stay for the second show?
Sure.
Like, you know, it's the same show, right?
Right.
And they're like, oh, really? And they don't know it. But then I think, well, that's because that was a really great show. People aren't going to ask, can I stay for the, if it was a bad show? And then it makes me think more about, like, why is that? And that's, to me, and what I enjoy about a show is because it feels like that person's coming up with those ideas and thoughts in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they aren't, but it doesn't sound calculated, does it?
Yeah, yeah.
And what I do see with some comics, some local guys, is that when they say the same thing over and over and over, it loses its magic. It's like the words don't sound the same. They don't have any meaning anymore because you've been saying them the same way for years. And so they almost come out clunky, like, in a mechanical way, but not really, like, the gears aren't working right because it doesn't sound pleasing to the ear. Then I think, well, that's, when you guys are talking about jazz, jazz is pleasing to the ear. It's like they're playing weird music. It sounds weird, but it's not. It's completely within the confines of certain rules, but they're, you know, they're dancing around the edges.
Yeah,
and people feel that. Do you find that to be true, like, with your stand-up? Do you feel like this is how I'm connecting with those people, or what is it really?
Yeah, like, I think, like, in terms of, like, saying the same stuff over and over again, you kind of got to feel excited about it still. Like, you know, and I think that's when the guy's getting all mechanical about it. Like, I've had that happen. Like, you're just going through the motions. You kind of got to feel like you're excited about it. And maybe it's just, like, you're changing. And it's tough because you can't change too much because then it'll work different. But, like, I always try to change, like, a tiny bit, like, an inflection or just, like, how I'm phrasing just the words, but I get it to the point. And that's what I was saying before, how I don't, like, fully, like, write shit out word for word. Like, I always have, like, approximations of what I'm going to say. But
does that also affect, like, the rhythm and the timing of how you deliver things?
I feel like regardless if, like, and when I'm talking about changes, it'd be, like, literally a word or something like that. But I always try to keep, like, the timing. I always try to, like, I've pretty aware of, like, where the timing is if I'm saying something, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome, yeah.
Yeah, comedy is a weird thing because you can just keep, it's like music too, in a way that you can keep doing the same jokes or the same songs for years, and that almost works to your benefit and then to your detriment if you do that. And so you do have to develop more, but people want to hear those things that they like to hear from that one person or group of people.
Yeah.
So comedy is really weird because then I think about other arts like painting or visual arts or something. You make a thing and then it's done. Then you got to make another one. You can't like, keep making that same painting over and over and reselling it to people. So that it's a weird aspect of comedy. Do you feel that pressure? Like, when should I get rid of this? What should I do with this thing? How should I move forward on the spectrum?
Well, it's a weird thing, and I think it's just like an anxiety in myself that kind of just only happens since I've been in New York. But like, I have a weird thing of like, I don't like being on shows with comedians that have seen me do a joke like more than two, three times.
Right.
Like, it makes me feel weird when I'm like in a room and it's like, you know, it's a show. Even if it's like there could be 150 people there that audience members have never seen it, it makes me feel weird. And I'm like, I gotta change this or like just do a totally different set. And there's been times where I've gone up and just like straight up just bombed because I'm like, I don't want to do any of these. I don't have nothing that's new that I like. I'm just going to go up there and talk and figure it out. And hopefully it works. Then it doesn't.
Like,
I do that because I just get a weird thing in my head. It's just like, I got to do something
fresh.
Yeah. And it's literally, there's been times where on big showcases where it's just like, you know, I'd be on a thing where it's like, so there's a network there that hadn't seen me or a big agent or whatever. Yeah. And then like, I'll literally throw in a couple jokes I've never even said before just because I get weird about it myself.
Yeah, that's really unique. I don't think a lot of guys I think they go the opposite way when the pressure's on.
Yeah, like I've always had this weird – I've always kind of had a thing where it's like, you know, everybody gets nervous. And I don't really necessarily get nervous, but I might get nervous in a different way. I get nervous about, like, people thinking, like, oh, Kevin just doing the same stuff. I get in my head.
Yeah.
And then I'll just be like, if there's, like, people there that could give you opportunities, there's, like, a network there, there's, like, agents, managers there. And a lot of times I'll go up, and it's like the smart thing to do would be stick to what you know works and stick to whatever. But a lot of times I'll go up there, and I'll just be like, well, you know, I'll probably be fine. Like, I've done that a lot where I'm like, even if this fucks something up for me, I feel like down the line I'll be all right.
Yeah.
You know, and I've done that a lot.
And that's a solid attitude to have, though, man. I think you have to almost nowadays.
Yeah,
you have to just be like, fuck it, I'm just going to wing this thing. And I think like that comes from like your jazz background then. Because that's basically what you're doing. You're just making a statement. And at the end of the day, you know there's going to be another gig. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's just
fuck
it. I'll go back to the next thing, you know?
Like, yeah.
That's what...
It's weird, though, as much as crazy. I, like, a lot of times, like, I'll think, like, oh, yeah, that's just kind of, like, a thing I've developed over time. It's kind of been how I've been. Like, I remember when I was in, this must have been, like, fourth or fifth grade, and I used to play, like, piano also.
Yeah.
And we were doing this is Miami, and we're playing at the Dade County Youth Fair, and it's probably, like, the biggest audience I'd been in front of in my life at that point. And I was supposed to be playing this piece, I think it was, like, Beethoven or something. And with classical piano, you have to, like, learn it, like, you memorize it. And so, like, the whole last, like, couple weeks, I'm not even looking at the music at all. Like, right. I just have it in my head.
Muscle memory.
So, you go up, and you're supposed to introduce yourself and the piece. And I remember, I was, like, 10 or whatever it was. And it's probably the first funny thing I've said on stage, too, where I was just, like, I went up. I'm like, what's up? I'm Kevin Barnett. I'm playing this piece by Beethoven. And it's called... You know what? Don't worry about that, man. I'm just going to play it. I sat down and I played it. It was just like, I feel like it's kind of just the attitude I've sort of had.
That's especially in that realm where it's classical is always like this prestigious.
Yeah.
Fuck it, it's Beethoven. You'll know it once
you
start playing.
You got a roar from the audience, right?
Yeah. It killed.
But how often do you think that works? Like, if you had to put a percentage on it, like, how often does that, when you go up and say, all right, caution to the wind, let's see what happens.
I don't know. I feel like it's kind of just been my whole, like, you know, because, you know, the guys will get mad about hecklers or whatever, and I kind of, like, I'm never, like, oh, I got to get through. I don't get pissed off if I'm, like, a bit is broken and I don't end up going through it or whatever. I'm like, let me talk to this person. I'm fine talking with them. I'll talk to them till they annoy me. It doesn't bother me, you know, if they're just going to say something. You know, it's like, whatever. I don't care about this joke, really.
Right.
If y'all want to hear it afterwards, I'll do it, but it's kind of like, and I'll do that a lot, too, where I'm just talking, and, like, if something pops into my head where it's not even a joke and it's not even really a thought, I'll just say it. Like, I'll be like, I'll be talking, and I'll be like, you know, I wonder what so-and-so, like, whatever this, you know.
Yeah.
I bring up Elian Gonzalez a lot randomly, but, like, I've just gone on, like, random rants about video games that no one understands at all, but I'll just be thinking about it, and I'll just start saying it, and it's half the time not funny, but I'll just, you know. Or I'll be talking and, like, literally I'm like, well, what should I do next? Yeah. And I'll just say it instead of, like, thinking in my head, what should I do next? I'm like, I'm trying to think of what I should do. You know, I just, I like doing that.
Sure.
Yeah. I like how you single out the audience until you get down to, like, maybe one guy that knows the reference to that game.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. One person gets it. Everyone's like, what? What's Zelda?
But that's, again, that's just making that statement and just saying, well, we're in the moment, so why not just indulge in it, you know? Fuck it, you know? Like, it's not the end of the world either way. I'm not curing cancer right now, you know?
Yeah.
Fuck it.
No, it's fine. It's like, I don't know. It's and again, sometimes it is to a fault. Like, I'm sure. You know, it's messed
There's
me up
be
in certain
people.
Situations, but I feel like that's just kind of like what I like doing. I remember one of the best examples of that, I was doing this show at a knitting factory, and it's a Hannibal show that he runs every Sunday. It's a place in Brooklyn called Knitting Factory. They do rock concerts, and he has his show on Sundays. And Chappelle was there, and that was the first time he'd ever come to the show, and he'd done it a bunch of times. And he'd asked Hannibal, like, you know, he was hiding, whatever, he was there, but he was, like, checking out a show in the back. Sure. There was, like, some band playing. And he was like, oh, so I'm going to go up. He put me up right before Chappelle. And he was like, Chappelle's like, I want to watch, like, one person. So I was like, all right. And so I went up right before Chappelle. And I wanted to do something that I'd never tried before. And then all of a sudden Chappelle is there and he's specifically watching me and I'm just like,
oh shit.
Well, you know, I'm still going to try this and I want to try it first. And usually the rule is you don't try new stuff first, but I'm like, I'm going to try this first. So I go up and I tried the new thing first and it got nothing. It got absolutely nothing at all. And then I just was like, well, it's all good. Man, I got a bunch of friends maybe texting me trying to hang out, some shit like that. And then that killed, and I just went in the rest of my set, and it was fine. And yeah. Then, like, Chappelle just, like, was mad, like, oh, fuck's fucking great, like, after it was, you know.
Really?
Yeah, so it was cool. It was just
that's
like.
That's awesome, man.
I've kind of always been, like, that kind of, like, all right, well, I'll just do this at whatever point I feel like doing it. And, you know, sometimes it doesn't work, but when it does, you know, it's dope.
Yeah,
it's
seems fun. Like you're addicted to that. Like, yeah, yeah, I'll just try this, and. Is it like an addiction or where you feel uncomfortable
yeah.
with doing the same thing, like being calculated about it? Is that?
Yeah, yeah, I kind of feel, and it's like, it's a thing where it's like, even when like I'm doing a long set or whatever like that, like I don't specifically have like an order or whatever. I just know like, this is a chunk of stuff I'm going to do. It's probably all going to go together. But within that chunk, half the time it's mixed and matched. And then whatever comes after that, like I'll just know that like I have chunks and they can come when they come or whatever. And I'll generally be like, I'll probably open this way and I'll probably end this way, but that sure. might change too.
It seems so interesting to me, man. Like, because really no cool. one else, I mean, we've talked about with other comics about certain things, but no one is that kind of freewheeling when it comes to their material on stage and just.
Yeah.
Trying in any setting with anyone in the audience, oh fuck it, let's try this. And I think that kind of develops you in a really unique way, and it maybe builds a callus like to the feeling that oof, that didn't work. Because it could, what I've seen is that once you, and what I've heard from other guys, like once it starts to go bad, it's hard to maybe
oh, yeah,
to reel it back
out.
In.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And
definitely.
It's like you don't seem to feel that pressure at all. It's like, eh.
I think
oh,
you
well.
Enjoy the uncomfortableness.
Oh, it. Yeah. Like, honestly, half the time, I love bombing. Like, it's just, it's bombing to me.
It's funny.
So funny.
Yeah,
it's just so,
funny.
The idea of, like, you know, all that stuff we're talking about, like, figuring out who you are and putting yourself out in the world. Like, you're bearing your soul for these people.
Right.
And for absolutely no one to relate, like, for a room full of people to not understand anything that you're saying. It's the funniest thing in the world. And then it's like, that just means that they hate you as a person. Like, whatever you've done has made them hate you. And they hate your soul, you know?
Just
and
by a few words, they turned on you.
Yeah, and that's so fucking funny to me. Like, I mean, there was another time at Knitting Factory where it was like these dudes, these guys from Chicago, Will Miles, Candy Forrest, Clark Jones, they had taken over the show for Hannibal. Hannibal got too busy, and it was their first time hosting the show. And I talked all this shit on Facebook. Like, I was talking shit, like, all week about how they were going to ruin it and they're bombing or whatever. And then I wasn't on the show. I went that night, and I was like, you know, just hating in the back. And they're just like, yo, you wanna go up? And I was like, oh, I didn't really want to. But then some people were like, oh, just go. I was like, all right, cool. I'll go up. And they're like, I'm only going to do like 5 minutes. Like, all right, cool. And I'm sitting there like, yeah, I'm about to fucking turn this show around, man. I'm about to crush this stuff. And I go up and just get nothing for like 3-4 minutes. And then I was only supposed to do 5. I told them I was going to do 5, yeah. But I was going to last. So I was like, you know what? I'm fucking staying. I leaned against the wall and just cursed out the audience for like another 20 minutes. And it was like the most fun I've ever had on stage.
Oh, that's yeah, that's fucking crazy, man.
That keeping that hostility, though. I mean, that I'm not trying to compare you to anybody, but, like, I remember, like, that was Bill Hicks' big thing, too, where he would just, like, go on those rants and, like, I mean, you would lose people at that point. I mean, you yeah. just make it so fucking hostile that, like, no one wants to be there. But it is in that uncomfortable moment where it's honesty. I mean, that's what it is, right?
Yeah,
you're just
yeah,
being
yeah.
honest. I mean, you guys are being assholes right now. Like, I'm trying to do this thing. You guys aren't engaging. Like, you know, that's where it gets interesting. I think that's where you don't know what's going to happen in those moments.
But you do find out yeah. what's funny, right? Because if they're not laughing just specifically because they dislike you, it's like
right.
maybe it's just not funny.
Well, that's
and
true.
And then that's
too.
A good,
that's
like,
true.
Yeah.
Like a really quick way to figure out whether or not something's good, right?
Right? Yeah, yeah.
Do you remember, like, do you take that off stage and go, fuck, that didn't work. All right, let's figure this out and then come back
yeah.
on with it.
I never blame the audience. I'm always like, all right, I did something. Even if it's something right. I know that works 100% of the time, I'm like, yeah. all right, clearly I did something wrong, you know? And so I'll always look at it and be like, all right, this didn't work and this is probably why, but I'm also weird. I never record sets. I probably should record sets.
But yeah, I was going to ask you that.
Yeah, I got a weird thing about listening to myself.
Yeah.
It's brutal. It's hard. I have to do it when I edit this thing, and I hate listening, even looking at it. I don't know why. Yeah, I've been thinking about that more. Like, is there something in our DNA that makes us reluctant to hear ourselves? Because you can hear yourself, you know, with your own ears, but it doesn't sound the same when you're listening back to it, and then also when you're watching it.
Well, I think there's most like artistic type of people never are happy. Well, I think, I don't know, if I had this theory that, like, you know, by posing that question of, is this thing going to suck? By doing that, just by posing the question, you're going to not let it suck because you're always trying to chip away and be better at something, right? Mm-hmm. I think it's just that constant, like, feeding to always be better with any artist. You know, I know with you and your paintings, every time I go over there, man, it's just like you're fucking always changing something. And it's just like, when do you just let it be, you know? And when do you let it just kind of be what it is?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think that's just the artistic brain of just never being happy.
Artists
are always fucking got this void that they're trying to fill with something. I don't know. That's I don't know. It's my bullshit theory.
Should ask, now are you going to record your sets?
I should. I don't know. That's the thing. It's like I've done, I did Montreal, I did a stand-up on Comedy Central, did the HBO Canada thing, and like I've never done a late night or anything, but literally, like, with the Comedy Central thing, it was, like, I was supposed to audition, and that's that whole thing of me, like, hating to have to, like, I have to do these jokes. I was supposed to audition, and then I had to go to L.A. for something, and I could have auditioned in L.A., and I didn't go.
Right.
And then the producers had known me and seen stuff, and they were like, all right, we'll just give it, we'll just let him do it. And it was the same thing with the HBO Canada thing. They were like, you know, I kind of just roll into stuff like that. There was, like, I was supposed to send them a transcript of my set. I just didn't. And then, like, and I get there and I just run it the night before. They're like, all right, that's cool. Do it. And it's just so, but with the late night, it's just like, I know I'm going to have to, I should have done one. Everyone's like, why haven't you done one yet? And it's like, you got to fucking run the set, like the same set three times a night, every night or whatever. And you got to be going back and forth with the booker and you got to be editing and all that. And it's just like, every time I'm like, all right, well, yeah, this time I'll start it this month or whatever. And then I'm like, man, fuck, I gotta sit there and plan this out, this exact same 6 minutes every night.
But in the way that, like you said, developing one-liners as opposed to your the way you do it now with long-form or stories, do you think that developing, like, a tight 5 minutes would help you in the end? Or you've learned something?
No, and it's like whenever I've had, like, I had to do it for Montreal, and I had to do it for, you know, a couple, I've had to do it here and there, but it's just like, and when I do, it's like, it is fun. Like, I'm like, oh, shit, this stuff has gotten so much tighter and so much better.
Right.
But I just, like, I don't know. I just have this whole thing. Like, man, I got to.
I got to get rid of this shit.
Yeah, I got to do something else.
Yeah.
I know. I should probably get over that, but that's just how I've, that's interesting, how kind of how I've been.
That's cool. Yeah. Where are we at on time? About an hour, man. Cool. Well, anything you plug in?
Plug away? Oh, yeah. Friends of the People airs July 16th at 10:30 on True TV is the premiere. So it'll be every Thursday, 10:30.
Oh, yeah, man.
True TV.
Not bad, awesome, man. Sounds great. And you'll be touring?
I'm just starting to get back out. Like, I have a few things here and there, but it's like I was like almost going to take this other job, and then I didn't. So now I'm just free, and so I'm getting back out.
Just getting out on the road. Trying new stuff. Awesome, man.
Well, we're glad to have you here.
Man.
This is your first time in Arizona, right?
Yeah. First time.
Hopefully it's not too weird. All right, cool. Man. Thank you so much, man. Really appreciate it, man. This is badass.
It's fun, man.